It's Home Time here on Absolute Radio, and our guest today, Ed Miliband, hello.
Great to be with you.
Well, I had a hard job choosing the music to introduce you with. I thought of Eye of the Tiger. Now that you... Can you give us a hell yeah?
Hell yeah.
Yeah, look at that. But I eventually settled on this. Which is, of course, the music from Manic Miner on the ZX Spectrum.
It is the music from Manic Miner.
Is that taking you back?
It certainly is.
Can you remember?
To being 12 years old?
Yeah.
How did you know about my passion for Manic Miner?
We've screened you. We've vetted you.
I was really good at Manic Miner, you know.
Well, congratulations.
I was. I think, as I remember, there were 20 levels.
Yeah.
Manic Miner.
I wasn't very good at it. And hand-eye coordination.
I'm not sure I'm very good at hand-eye coordination either, but I was good at Manic Miner. I think, as I remember, 20 levels. And I think I used to drive my parents slightly mad because, you know, you used to have to play it on the telly, obviously.
Yeah.
It was connected up to the
telly.
And
they wouldn't be able to watch TV.
And it would, like, take an hour.
Did you ever finish the 20th level?
I think I may have done, you know.
Well, congratulations.
I
hope that isn't the peak of your life.
Well, no,
but still,
it was a pretty important moment, frankly.
I want to talk about this word geek. To me, it's weird that...
It's a compliment.
Bill Gates, Mark Zuckerberg, Steve Jobs, these are geeks. Why don't you embrace your inner geek and say, yes, I am a geek and I'm proud.
I plead guilty.
You're proud of it.
Proud.
Can I check some geeky things with you? Have you ever played Dungeons and Dragons?
No.
Have you ever been a member of a chess club?
No.
Have you ever spotted a train deliberately?
Nope.
So you're failing on the geek,
excellent,
geek score here.
I'm relieved of geekdom. You're relieving me of geekdom.
Let's check you with some non-geeky things. Have you ever chopped wood with an axe?
Nope.
Ever downed a pint?
Yes. Well, in one go, no.
Yeah, in one go, yeah.
No.
Have you ever pulled a Mooney?
No.
So you're somewhere in between.
You're
in a hinterland.
It's David Cameron you're thinking of.
I think I read about you is you had to give up your iPhone because you were so obsessive about checking Twitter and political commentary.
Yeah,
is that true?
The good thing about a BlackBerry, I'm going to insult the BlackBerry makers now, is that it's sort of harder to kind of do those things.
Right.
And so it's sort of, you know, it's more limited functionality, I think they call it.
Uh-huh.
But the best times are when I switch off my BlackBerry.
So were you ever an app man?
Somewhat. I mean, my sort of secret passion is the Boston Red Sox baseball team. And you're not a great sports fan, are you?
No, not at all.
No. But anyway.
I'm glazing over here.
I noticed. So I lived in America for a bit and with my dad, and I became a big, big baseball fan. So there's an MLB app, MLB. Major League Baseball, in other words.
And you're getting all the information.
Well, the great
thing
is, which is different from when I was a kid, is you can actually watch the games live. Now, I've got one or two other things to do at the moment.
Here's the thing about this type of interview, and you'll be doing a lot of them between now and the election day.
Not as important as this.
No, of course not. But there's a lot of trying to convince listeners and voters and viewers, oh, look, it's just like one of us. Like, why is it not acceptable to say, look, I'm working till midnight, I'm reading reports, I'm thinking about ideas. I haven't got time to have an opinion on Top Gear. Why can't you
I
just
definitely
say
don't
that?
Have time to have an opinion on Top Gear.
But why is it so important to talk about this stuff?
Well, the way I view it is you should talk about what you know about. And so if you ask me a question about, you know, the last episode of Top Gear, well, we obviously know what's happened to Clarkson.
Yeah.
But, you know, then I'm not going to kind of pretend that I know about it when I don't.
So you're not swatting up on this stuff before you come in for an interview?
I'm not swatting up on it. It's quite important to know broadly what's happening in the news.
Yeah.
But I'm not
the pop culture stuff.
I'm more interested in, you know, sort of swatting up on what's happening in the Middle East rather than Top Gear.
We've been asking people for questions.
Oh, good.
For you.
Good.
Let's hear from the first one. Let's hear who this is.
Hi, Ed. This is Geoffrey Boycott here.
Geoffrey Boycott, big hero he is, right?
Fantastic!
Do you remember what one of your great sporting memories was?
I could go on for hours about Geoffrey Boycott. I saw his... Can I say?
Yeah, yeah.
I saw his 100th. That doesn't mean anything to you, I know.
I'm a proper geek.
Yeah, so that's like, he's scored 100 times in 1977. And it was my first cricket match I'd been to, and it was England versus Australia. And ever since then, I was Geoff's greatest fan.
Well, let's hear his question.
I know you love cricket, and after England's pathetic performances at this World Cup, if you were the incoming chairman of the English Cricket Board, what would you do to restore pride and get our team playing well again with a chance of beating New Zealand and Australia this summer? And secondly, do you think some of England's matches should be shown live on terrestrial television?
Oh, no, this is a big...
It's a double whammy, so you've got terrestrial TV.
This is a big Geoff Boycott passion. I've talked to him about this. The second thing I've talked to him about, because, you know, it's because they're all on Sky. And,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Nobody, I'd love to more of them to be on terrestrial, to be honest.
Is that something the government can do? I know the EU has certain rules.
It's hard for the government to do it, but I mean, I'd love that to happen, because I think there's a danger for cricket that, you know, it ends up only being on Sky and that fewer people watch it and the game, you know, dwindles a bit. As for his first question, I sort of think I should slightly leave the England's troubles to them. But clearly, I think the answer that Geoff would want me to say is that he should be more involved in selecting. You know, maybe Geoff Boycott, chairman of the selectors. I think that would probably be the answer.
All right, who's the next question from?
Hi, Ed, it's Willie Thorne here.
Willie Thorne, you were Snooker Loopy as a young man.
I was.
Did you have that song, Snooker Loopy?
Definitely, definitely.
Yeah.
Chaz and Dave.
Yeah, so let's hear what Willie Thorne has to ask.
I understand you watched the 1985 final when your father let you stay up to watch Dennis Taylor and Steve Davis, when amazingly enough 18 and a half million viewers after midnight watched that game. Do you still get a chance to watch it now with your busy schedule? And do you play yourself?
So I play pool.
Uh-huh.
A secret vice.
This is I'm your Atlanticism. This is your American side,
a little
right?
bit. I'm not bad at pool.
Shall we have another question? Who's the final one from?
Hi, Mr. Miliband. This is Ali from your favourite restaurant, Monsoon Kanchistan.
Fantastic.
This is the proprietor of your local Indian restaurant.
Yes, how often they've got me on the menu, if you know what I mean. They say this is my favourite restaurant.
How spicy do you go?
Not that spicy.
Because David Cameron has said that he goes very spicy.
Does he really?
So, you know, instead of challenging him to a debate,
that shows what a tough spice off. That shows what a tough guy he is, doesn't it?
Right, well, shall we hear Ali's question?
Yeah, I would like to ask Mr. Miliband whether my spicy curry at Monsoon Restaurant improved his speech.
Well, does it improve your speech?
Definitely. Definitely. Although I chicken tikka tandoori, so I'm not sort of I'm not a massive... hot spice person.
You don't want to go too far. You don't want to be sweating during these speeches.
That's not great.
The wrong way.
The sweating would go down badly, I think.
We should play a song at this point. I'm going to give you a choice. You can either go with your famously uncredible taste of music and go with Aha. We could play Take On Me. Or we could play some hip young gunslingers off the playlist, Catfish and the Bottle Men. Which do you want to do?
Can I make another choice?
Yeah.
So, Bastille.
Oh my God, really?
Is that bad?
No, but I'm amazed that you know it.
Well, you know, the only reason I know
You're sure
it,
somebody hasn't told you
no,
about this
No, I'll tell
advance.
You why they haven't told me. Because Ellie Goulding, you know Ellie Goulding?
Yeah, yeah.
She invited me to a concert that she was doing a homeless benefit in December. And obviously she's great and I love her. But there was also this band Bastille there, which I confess I hadn't heard of. And they have this song Pompeii, which I'm sure you have heard of.
Yeah, let's go and get Bastille tattoos while it's playing.
don't call me, I'll call you, I think, on that one.
It's Absolute Radio. Our guest today is Ed Miliband. I've got a bit of music to introduce the second part of the interview. That's enough of that, because you own a Blue Peter badge.
This is total mythology. Can I just say?
This is total mythology.
I wish I owned a Blue Peter badge.
Reputable news sources have reported
on
this.
The only thing I can claim on this is I met John Noakes once at King's Cross train station.
Was Shep with him?
Yeah, that's funny. Everybody asked me that.
We're more interested in Shep.
I remember asking for his autograph. I must have been about 10 years old, and he was sort of moderately friendly, I would say.
So this is an apocryphal story. You never went on Blue Peter reciting the names of prime ministers.
Is that around?
Can you do that? Can you recite the name of every...
No, I bet. Don't try me on that. But I wish... I mean, maybe I should be sort of pretending that I did get a Blue Peter badge, but I sadly never did.
We'd call you out on it. I mean, it would be a terrible scandal.
Biddy Baxter.
Something else I read about you that I'm intrigued by, but it could turn out that this isn't true either. When you're a kid, you don't call your mum and dad, you call them by the first names.
I'm afraid that's another myth.
Really? I'm thinking this is one of those progressive families.
I know.
And were you
it would have been quite nice, but no, I didn't. I called them mum and dad.
And were you an Eddie or are you an Edward in the family?
So I was quite a lot of things. I was an Edward. Partly when I lived in America, I mentioned that earlier, I was an Eddie.
Mm-hmm.
I was a Ted at university.
That's a great one. I thought that should be for Theodore.
Yeah, I know. I sort of became a Ted briefly, but I'm happy with Ed.
When you're in trouble, does your mum call you Edward?
Yes.
After
she's very,
found out,
very stern.
When she found out,
she doesn't like one of our policies.
When she found out you're running against David, she go, "Oh,
she
Edward!"
No, she didn't.
Look what you've done.
No, she didn't.
Did you and David have bunk beds?
No.
I've got a question. Like, here's something I don't understand. I'm working in a company.
Yeah.
I'm at executive level. My brother.
Yeah.
Is at a junior level.
Yeah.
The chief executive's job comes up. We both go for it. What is the problem with that? Why do you think that people have got such a bee in the bonnet about this stuff? What is it that's annoying to people, and do you understand it?
Well, look, maybe there are some older brothers out there who were, you know, older siblings. Look, I think what people... Well, I sort of take the view you do, frankly. You know, I sort of take the view... We offer different things for the Labour Party. I was a person that thought we needed to move on from New Labour. And, you know, I ran for the same reasons that I'm running for Prime Minister now, which is I think the country's unfair. It helps, works for the richest in our society, doesn't work for most people. We've got to change that. So we really do put, you know, everyday people, working people first. So... Yeah, I'm
It's a weird one, right? You've had a lot of hostility. People have been very mean to you, and you've repeatedly said, "Doesn't bother you." I don't understand that. Like, how can it not bother you? How are you not in the fetal position every morning and just in sleep? Come on, Ed. Come on, you can do it. How are you not doing that? How are you thick-skinned?
Why am I thick-skinned? You mean?
Yeah, like what?
I think it's just comes with the territory of the job. I mean, you know, and I also. You know what's kept me going throughout all this is a sort of inner belief of the things I believe in. I think if I was just running for this job because I wanted my face on the wall of, you know, inside Downing Street, then that wouldn't be enough of a motivation. That's like just a power motivation. My motivation is to change the country.
And it's never made you sob any of this stuff?
Definitely not.
Are you an easy...
Well, because Rupert Murdoch doesn't like me. I mean...
Yeah, people in your own party plotting against you, or like commentators constantly being mean about you. That doesn't. I would be bawling every day.
No, you know the interesting thing about the party is that if you look at the history of Labour in opposition, we've been a much, much more united party in these past 5 years than any time in the past, and that's because we've been focused on the people of the country and how do we change things for the people of the country, not in you know, looking inwards.
Do you cry easily at films and television?
Yeah.
What was the last thing you cried at?
Pride. Have you seen Pride?
Yeah, it's a great film.
So Pride is about these lesbian and gay community in London who, you know, go and help the miners in Wales. And Justine and I watched it recently.
And you were in
floods. I blubbed.
What makes you laugh?
Quite a lot of things, actually.
Are you a comedy fan?
I'm a bit of a comedy fan.
I know Larry David is one that
Larry David I like.
What else?
Woody Allen I like. Mm-hmm. Larry Sanders, I know, has not been on for a long time.
Oh, what a great show that was, yeah.
It was a great show.
Martin Freeman, yesterday you put out a Labour video in that he's talking about Labour values like kindness and compassion. Mm. When you look at your own immigration policy, do you see kindness and compassion reflected in that?
Definitely. Because I think that we absolutely should recognise that immigration benefits our country. But we've got to make the rules work for people. Because there's nothing worse than people feeling like, you know, the rules aren't working for them. So just take an example, which is immigrant labour being exploited, not the minimum wage not being paid, people being, you know, housed in terrible conditions. That's bad for people coming here, but it's also bad for people already here because it undercuts the wages. And, you know, there's nothing progressive about workers not being paid them the minimum wage, 15 people being put in a room, all of that.
So why aren't you talking more about those things like housing or like the minimum wage being exploited rather than, oh, these people come here, they're not getting benefits? Like, there's this idea that people are coming and taking, which actually statistically isn't backed up.
On the benefits issue, I think it is important. This has always been part of our welfare system, that you contribute before you claim. That's all we've said. So, you know, if you come here, you won't get benefits for at least the first 2 years. But on the exploitation point, absolutely we're talking about it. And look, we won't just talk about ending exploitation. We'll raise the minimum wage to £8 an hour. We're going to deal with those, ban those exploitative 0 hours contracts that, you know, are such an epidemic in our country. The Prime Minister says he couldn't live on one. Well, nor could I. But he's going to just carry them on regardless. So, you know, absolutely we'll deal with those things.
Have your sons given you any ideas for policies?
4 and 5, not quite
yet. Free chocolate for all 4 and 5 year olds.
I'm sure they would think that's very good. They're more interested in the octonauts. You know the octonauts?
I don't.
They're 8 sea creatures who go on adventures.
Wow. Should we go and watch the octonauts now,
we
Ed?
We should go and watch the octonauts.
That's it. Our time is up. Ed Miliband, Labour leader. Thank you very much.
I've really enjoyed it.
Thank you. Are you okay, Ed?
Yeah.
Fine.
Yeah, I'm very good. How are you?
Yeah, very good.